Hi, I'm Tim Berglund with StarTree. Pinot 0.11 is out, and I'd like to run through some of the major features that made it into this release. Let's jump in. First off, you can now view indexes in the Pinot UI in the browser. Now, you've always been able to do this with a REST API, but now you've got the nice browser-based way to do it. It's a lot cleaner and easier if you're not, you know, hands-on in the REST API all the time. And I want to point out, on many of the slides here for the features I'm listing, you see there's a QR code at the upper right. That's going to take you to a blog post or a docs page or some appropriate resource that gives you more detail. So be sure to scan those, do whatever you need, and you can get to that additional resource, for example, on viewing indexes in the UI. The timestamp index, this is really cool. Now, timestamp has been a data type since 0.8, but now we've got a super effective way to build an index on a timestamp field. Used to be, if you were going to filter by timestamp, there would probably be a whole column scan, and maybe you'd have to convert the native timestamp into some other time format. That's pretty expensive, didn't go well. So now with the timestamp index, the index will create a hidden column that effectively bins your timestamps into the grain that you specify when you build the index. So if you want to query by day, say a grain of day or minute or second or whatever that is, then you'll get this hidden column built for you reduces the actual timestamp into that bin, and then it effectively creates a range index on that column. So you get very, very fast time lookups according to the grain you specify. Super simple and a great addition to the timestamp data type. Now, the insert into statement. This is not quite like what you'd expect an insert into to be in a transactional database where you're actually specifying values and columns and a table name. This is actually setting up an import job to ingest static data into Pinot. So if you look at the query here, you'll see that it's specifying a file off in S3, task name, and you have to set some properties like for access to that S3 bucket and so on and so forth. You know, there's a lot of those options that you'll need to check the docs for, linked in the QR code, but this is a super handy SQL-based way to set up an ingest of static data. You can now pause and resume stream consumption into a real-time table. So things go wrong in the world, right? Maybe you have to reset offsets in a Kafka topic because something broke, or maybe you have to destroy an old topic and create a new one that's got the data. Any number of things could be going wrong out in the world that you're ingesting your streaming data from. So you can now instruct Pinot to say, would you please pause consumption from that topic, you go do your stuff in the source, you won't be getting errors during that time, and then resume consumption. It's just a much more orderly way of repairing things in flight. Interpolating query results. Now, everybody is going to see this kind of thing in time series data, right? Suppose you've got data that you're acquiring once a millisecond or once a second, or I don't know, once a day. It could be infrequent. There are probably going to be gaps in that data collection somehow. Again, just like the pause and resume stream consumption thing, things break. Now, you want this periodic data acquisition. It doesn't always happen. And now you can, in a query, and I'll show you the actual query here, a somewhat complex query, you might want to pause and take that in. But in the query, you can say, hey, I know there might be gaps here, and Pinot, I want you to do some interpolating there. Now, the kind of interpolating it will do right now is either repeating the last value or filling in with a standard value. So fairly simple, but now you can get at least a smoother reporting of time series data where you've got missing values by asking for interpolation. And there is now a Flink Pinot connector. So for batch ingestion jobs, there has long been a Spark and a Hadoop connector. So you can have a Hadoop job or more likely a Spark job directly creating Pinot segments from some kind of you know, batch computation of source data, whatever it might be. You can actually create Pinot segments, load them into an offline table in batch mode. Now, when we're ingesting streaming data into a real-time table, it isn't always the case that you just have the topic you need and you connect to the pipe and start ingesting that and everything's great. Sometimes you have to do some stream processing. That might be done in Kafka Streams, and commonly it's done in Flink. So there might be several topics, you do some kind of enrichment, some kind of streaming computation, and that results in the Kafka topic that you want to ingest into Pinot. And that's what you used to have to do with streaming data if you're doing it with Flink. You've got your Flink job. It's consuming potentially from multiple Kafka topics. You would have, prior to 0.11, had to then output back to a Kafka topic because that was the only way to get into a real-time table, right? Now that there's a Flink connector, we're able to have Flink produce effectively directly to Pinot without that intermediary Kafka topic. So a handier thing. It's always a little bit of a pain, right? If you've got this batch flow and this real-time flow, nobody likes that life. Well, now that life has gotten a little bit easier because you're not having to round trip back to Kafka before you come into Pinot. Now, another real-time table ingest feature, deduplication. So duplicate records may exist in the input stream in that topic that you're ingesting into your real-time table, and you may not want to see them. So now you can, as a matter of table configuration, specify that you would like duplicates removed. And of course, that's going to rely on the schema having a primary key so that we can know what a duplicate even is. And if you're thinking this sounds like a particular kind of upsert configuration, you're right. They're semantically equivalent. This is another great thing that we can do in Pinot with upserts. Spark 3 support, not much to say about this, except that there is now Spark 3 support. So if you've got a batch job in Spark that's creating Pinot segments that you want to load into an offline table, you can now do that with the Spark 3.x line. Those APIs are now compatible. So good news if you're on Spark 3. The last feature I've got for you in this video, and I don't know, maybe it's the biggest, this is the multi-stage query engine. Now, this is not ready for production use yet, okay? So it's marked as beta here. You can call it pre-release, you can call it whatever you want. It's there. It's in the 0.11 release, and if you happen to build from source, building from the most current of the main branch might be an even better thing to do. So you want to keep up on this. It's changing rapidly, being a pre-release thing, but very, very important feature. Now, this has a lot of implications, but the biggie you want to think about is general purpose joins. Now, it used to be the case, and if you read the docs, it explains this a little bit, that the broker used to be the bottleneck. The broker would scatter queries to servers. Servers would do what they could locally with what segments they had. And the broker would then gather results back and it would do result reducing. And that made general purpose joins very, very expensive. We say prohibitively expensive, right? Now the multi-stage query engine, just like it says on the label, is able to push that down into servers. So you'll still have servers at the base level, scanning tables, processing indexes, doing filtering, doing whatever aggregations they can locally. And then there's a stage that might remind you of a shuffle going on there where those servers now might report intermediate results to other servers, which are able to do that result merging with reference to potentially other queries going on in that intermediate stage. So you can see something that looks a lot more like what you might need to do a general purpose join reflected in this architecture here. It's not all on the poor broker. It was not feasible to get that much data in and out of the broker and for the data to deal with that much data. So those joins just didn't happen. Now with this multi-stage query engine, they are a possibility. So you want to check this out. Again, it's in 0.11, changing rapidly. So if you're building from source, that's worth it. Check out the docs. There's more to say here. This is going to be a game changer. I don't even think I can say you heard it here first. I think this has been known in the Pinot community. This is a big deal, and I encourage you to check it out. And that's what I've got for 0.11. So this QR code here will get you to StarTree Community Slack, where you can ask more questions about these features, get access to more resources. We have sample code for you. That's the place to go. There'll be engineers and folks from the developer relations team very eager to help you. We're going to be doing more of these release videos on future Pinot versions. So if you want to know about those, be sure to subscribe, youtube.com/@StarTree, so you can find out about those. And as always, we look forward to hearing what you build.